You've been a little, yeah, very secretive. Well, and then when you mentioned North Korea,
right,
it made sense why it was probably
nothing makes you think of film music like North Korea, right?
It's true. It's a stretch, but tell us how this all came about.
So basically, and this was a good opportunity for us to be able to basically announce what has been going on behind the scenes. And I think I've maybe dropped very subtle hints to the both of you, but we haven't really talked about it. So this is kind of, was actually working with a couple news outlets to maybe put something out there, but we thought, you know what, our Score listeners are the people who would be interested in this. And basically what we did,
let me guess, you teamed up with Dennis Rodman. No?
It's something like
okay,
that.
Okay.
You guys are well aware of our movie, Score, a Film Music Documentary, which came out a couple years ago. And about 1 year ago, I came across a group called the Human Rights Foundation, which is involved in a lot of things in North Korea. A lot of it is trying to get information to the people of North Korea that do not have access to it. It must be state-sanctioned media. Anything that they consume has to come from the state, has to be approved, has to, you know, be censored if it comes from anywhere else. So it's extremely locked down.
It's not a free world.
Not at all. And under insane penalties. In some cases, it could be, you know, as harsh as death. I mean, it's not a good place. And this is a country that's it's half the size of California. You know, it's 26 million people or something that live in North Korea that do not have access to the outside world. It's been locked down basically since the 1950s. So we came across this group, the Human Rights Foundation, which is involved in basically smuggling culture from outside countries into this extremely locked down, repressive kind of state. And the idea behind this is, you know, there's a famous video from 10 years ago, maybe 15 years ago, of a North Korean defector who escaped. And she said, the thing that made me realize that, you know, there was more to the world than what we were being told was I saw a depiction of love in Titanic. And that was something that, which Robert worked on. But that was something that was so moving that they realized there's more to life than just what we're being told here in this very locked down world. So, this group, the Human Rights Foundation, said, you know what, we haven't done this before with pure culture. Usually they're smuggling in information or other tools or other, you know, things that are more kind of politically, subversive, I guess, let's say. And, in this case, they said, let's try something that's more cultural diplomacy and being able to kind of bring the people of North Korea up to speed on the last 70 years of culture. You know, if you think about the biggest world culture that exists in the world, it's film. And the biggest part of film that crosses all languages is the music. So they said your documentary is a great ambassador for this culture that the whole world has shared for the last half century. And that's something that we think people would really be interested in there.
Oh, cool.
So, so we started working on this project and lined up some different partners, some people that basically did this operation to load up thousands of flash drives, little flash drives with our movie on there, a Korean subtitled version of that, as well as some other materials. And started an operation to basically import those into North Korea through the kind of the farms at the edge of the country. And what they did was they loaded up bottles of rice so they would float, and the currents washed those ashore on these farms. And so all of these local farmers and other people that are part of these efforts usually will go through there and pick out the things that wash up on shore, and sometimes there are things that help them, and sometimes there's, you know, it's just trash or something else washing up, but that's how they get a hold of these flash drives. And there is a thriving underground, you know, black market for flash drives in North Korea. They expect, I think the Human Rights Foundation says it's something like 1 in 4 people has accessed black market material through flash drives. Excuse me. And which is an amazing number if you think about it. And that's growing every year, is more and more people are accessing this. And it's very difficult to track because you can plug it in, this little USB drive, to the video players that are given to them by the state to receive their state information, you know, what the government says they should be doing. So this is a really interesting project to us. And we said, yeah, let's do it. And so we helped kind of fund the start of this operation. And now basically what we're doing is trying to continue that on for people who are interested in maybe being a part of this. We built a website, a web page here, score-movie.com/North Korea. And right on there, there are some ways you can help out. You can, you know, get your own kind of score flash drive that we have. And for every one that you purchase, we'll also donate another one to North Korea and help kind of fund the efforts to keep this all going. But that's kind of the top secret mission here, which I didn't anticipate we would be in with a movie that's about, isn't film music cool? But it's something that does reach out to a lot of other cultures and allows us to do what I thought Score, the documentary, did so well in the first place, which was celebrate this huge cultural thing that nobody had made a movie about before. And that's something that I think speaks to people all over the world.
It's really, I mean, the whole thing is remarkable. I don't know which part of that was more surprising. I mean, the idea that it's in these bottles that wash up, kind of rice-filled bottles. That's how you think about distribution networks. Well, we have Netflix, and we have Apple, and we have films going to theaters.
Did you watch the new rice bottle movie that came out?
Oh, my God. But I really appreciated the fact that you said they're hard to track, because my number one concern, I'm all for freedom and democracy, but my name's on that movie. and so I think Kenny's is, too. So do we...
We're not allowed in North Korea.
Right.
Now.
Well, okay. Phew. If that's the only thing, I just don't know if people are going to be showing up in my rearview mirror because Score, the film, was shown in Pyongyang. So, Matt, what do you have any
Well, I
fear?
Don't think the word will be getting out very far because it's a pretty underground thing if people are accessing it. But no, I mean, I think it's there's a, you know, we talk about humanitarian crises all over the world. And it's easy to think of North Korea as kind of this isolated state of people who, you know, have this kind of tyrannical ruler. And, you know, that's been in the news a lot lately. But think of that as its own kind of siloed state. But the truth is those people are constantly under siege. You know, they're encouraged to turn in their own family members if they're doing something that's not approved. And it's seen as everyone reports to the state, and anyone that fails to do that risks their own, you know, potentially incredibly harsh, you know, they could be imprisoned or worse. And this is something that, you know, the Human Rights Foundation did not view as politically sensitive. Because nice. This is, you know, this isn't a film going in there and saying North Korea is bad, here's how. But this is something that is you know, can function as kind of a soft cultural revelation to a lot of people that have no idea that there's a world of information
really
and a
wonderful.
World of, you know, extremely high-end cinema. That's they're not stories that say, isn't North Korea terrible? They're stories that say this is about love. This is about, you know, something that's about defeating the bad guys. This is, you know, Star Wars. This is about
it's crazy
Indiana
to,
Jones.
It's
James
crazy
Bond.
To point out too that some people may not realize this, but like Jaws didn't get released in North Korea,
right?
And these films that are like staples in our culture, in our world, all across the world, all languages, it just doesn't happen there.
Right? It's not in the zeitgeist the same way. And now, you know, we can even, you'll hear somebody go, you know, make a joke and say, dun. You know that that's, oh, they're that's a little reference to the Jaws theme.
And that could be someone in Japan.
Right. It could be all over the world.
Yeah.
And it's so baked in. But that's not a part of daily life in North Korea. And in fact, if that were, it could be dangerous for someone to reference something, you know, maybe not the tune, maybe not the theme, but some other aspect of a film like that. So ultimately, you know, what we're looking to do with this and what was intriguing to me personally and why you guys were kind of left in the dark was I wanted to, this seemed like an important cause, you know, to try to catch up millions of people, potentially. If you think 1 in 4 out of 26 million people, you know, it's potentially millions of people that this black market reaches. And this is a, you know, our movie's a 2.5 hour or 1.5 hour sliver of 50 years of culture. And all of these things that, you know, the music that's rousing, that makes you feel, that makes you realize like these stories are part of something that everyone everywhere else shares. And this is something that I think is important for people of North Korea to be able to know exists.